Everyone, today in this video I will talk about how to approach a case of bleeding disorder. Whenever it is coming with the bleeding, then we have to think either it may be platelet disorder, which is the commonest one, or it can be coagulation disorders, or it can be von Willebrand disease, or it can be vasculitis. So we have to approach all these causes one by one. I will tell you in detail all these causes, how to approach clinically and how to approach by investigations. So to make the clinical diagnosis, according to the site of bleeding, we can suspect either it is platelet or coagulation disorder. So if the bleeding is in joint and muscle, that means in deep tissues, as in this picture you can see, the child is having the hemarthrosis, bleeding in joint. So we have to suspect the coagulation disorder, because this is characteristic of coagulation disorder. This is the hallmark of coagulation disorder. The child is coming with the bleeding in joint and muscle. If the child is having bleeding in skin, mucous membrane, as in this picture you can see, the child is having petechiae and purpura, then you have to suspect the platelet and vascular abnormality. In this, child can present as a epistaxis, bleeding from gums, bleeding from the GIT. So all these are characteristic sites of bleeding in platelet disorders and in vasculitis. Now, according to the type of bleeding, as in this picture you can see, child is having hemarthrosis. So if the hematoma, ecchymosis is there, then you have to suspect coagulation disorder. If petechiae and purpura, then you have to suspect the platelet and vascular abnormality. If there is a history of trauma or surgery, after surgery child is having the bleeding, or if after trauma bleeding manifestations are there, then you have to suspect coagulation disorder. It is not hard and fast, but most of the time in coagulation disorder, you will find the history of trauma and surgery. While in the platelet and vascular abnormality, spontaneous bleeding from the skin, mucous membrane will be present. So by this way, we can make the clinical approach. And also we have to ask about the any drug history, because many drugs affect the hemostasis. Example, aspirin, clopidogrel, and anticonvulsant drug which we are routinely prescribing to the children as valproic acid, carbamazepine, phenytoin, all these affect the hemostasis. So drug history, and also we have to ask about the family history, history of consanguineous marriages, because inherited disorder or congenital disorder can be ruled out. So this is clinical approach. How to approach according to investigations? There are various investigations for the bleeding disorder. First, we have to send a screening test. So probable diagnosis, either it is platelet coagulation or von Willebrand or vasculitis. And according to the result of screening test, we have to send the specific test. Otherwise, tests are very numerous and very expensive. So first, in screening test should be sent. In this, we generally send the complete blood count, in which the specifically for the platelets, then the bleeding times, platelet function analyzer, platelet aggregation, peripheral blood smear should be sent. Then for the coagulation, prothrombin time, activity, partial thromboplastin time, thrombin time, and if you are suspecting inhibitors, then the mixing studies. And according to the result of a screening test, a specific clotting factor assay should be sent, and Bethesda test to find out the inhibitors. As I said, we have to send the screening test. In a screening test, we have to send the CBC, PT, APTT, BT, TT, and PFA and BBS. And according to the screening test, we have to make the probable diagnosis. If you find that CBC is normal, platelet counts are normal, bleeding time, platelet function analyzer and PBS is totally normal. Only either PT, APTT and TT is abnormal. Then you have to suspect coagulation disorder is there. Now you have to go further because there are various coagulation disorder. If you find only APTT is prolonged, PT is normal, then you have to suspect the intrinsic pathway defect because APTT is specifically for the intrinsic pathway. So in an intrinsic pathway, factor 8th, 9th, 11th and 12th deficiency, you have to suspect. And also von Willebrand disease, because in von Willebrand disease also APTT will be prolonged, because we know von Willebrand is a carrier protein for the factor 8th. If the patient is having the VWD disease, then the due to the deficiency of von Willebrand factor, factor 8th half-life will be reduced from 24 to 2 hours. Okay, so normal half-life of the factor 8th is around 12 to 24 hours if the von Willebrand factor is normal. If von Willebrand factor is deficit, then the half-life of factor 8th will be reduced to only 2 to 4 hours. So in this condition, you will find the child is having the bleeding and APTT will be prolonged. So in another condition, if the PT is prolonged while the APTT is normal, that means extrinsic pathway defect is there. So in this case, you will find factor 7th deficiency. So whenever a child is having the severe bleeding manifestation and the PT is prolonged while the APTT is normal, then you have to go for the 7 factor assay. Now if both are prolonged, PT and APTT both, then the common pathway factors can be deficit. So factor 1, 2, 5 or 10 deficiency should be ruled out. So now if the child is having APTT prolonged and PT normal, then you are having the factor 8th, 9th, 11th, 12th or von Willebrand disease. So in this, if the child is having severe bleeding, that means child is having either factor 8th or 9th deficiency, because in these two factors deficiency, child will present with the severe bleeding manifestation in the form of hemarthrosis, muscle bleeding, sometime even cranial bleeding also. So severe bleeding manifestations will be there, and these bleeding manifestations are after trauma or injury. So you have to rule out the factor 8th deficiency known as hemophilia A or factor 9th deficiency hemophilia B by the specific clotting factor assay. If the APTT is prolonged even longer than it is seen in the patient with the severe hemophilia AB, but the bleeding manifestations are mild to moderate, then you have to suspect factor 11 deficiency, which is known as hemophilia C. So if the bleeding manifestations are not proportionate to the increase in APTT, and APTT is even more prolonged compared to the hemophilia A and B, and bleeding manifestations are mild, then you have to suspect factor 11 deficiency. If child is asymptomatic, not having any symptoms, and coincidentally you find that APTT is prolonged while the PT is normal, then you have to think about factor 12th deficiency or prekallikrein or high molecular weight kininogen deficiency. In these three deficiency, child will be asymptomatic and you will find APTT is prolonged. And in this case, you need not to treat and need not to be worried. Now, if PT and APTT both are prolonged, then you have to go for the thrombin time and reptilase time. If TT and RT both are prolonged, that means child is having factor 1 deficiency, which is also known as congenital afibrofibrinogenemia or dysfibrinogenemia. If child is having only TT is prolonged while the RT is normal, that means it is due to heparinization. or heparin is given or you have collected the sample in heparinized vial. If both are normal, thrombin time and reptilase time both are normal, that means either factor 2nd, 5th or 10th deficiency, or it can be due to acquired causes, vitamin K deficiency, due to liver disease, or it can be due to DIC. So if both are prolonged, PT and APTT, then you have to make, is it inherited disorder or is it acquired? So in acquired causes, vitamin K deficiency, which is very common, and liver disease and DIC should be ruled out. For this, if the vitamin K deficiency, then pupa level should be done. And if child is having any signs symptoms of liver disease, LFT are deranged, or any signs symptoms of the liver disease, then you have to first rule out this. If child is having the DIC, then you have to perform the fibrinogen D-dimer test. All these, according to the FDP, all these you have to rule out the DIC. Now if PT, APTT or TT, anything is prolonged and you are suspecting inhibitors, then you have to perform the mixing studies. In this, if after doing this test, if PT, APTT or TT is not corrected, I will tell you the details of all these investigation after this, how to perform the mixing study and what are the significance. So if after doing this study, if it is not corrected, that means inhibitors are there and you have to rule out, example, lupus anticoagulant in SLE, viral infection in HIV. If PT, APTT or TT is corrected, that means child is having clotting factor deficiency, and according to the, either it is only PT or APTT or TT or all three, as I said before, the specific clotting factor assay should be performed. Now, if in a screening test you find all the screening tests are normal, then you have to perform the clot solubility test, because factor 13 deficiency, in factor 13 deficiency, PT, APTT, TT all will be normal. So in this, you have to perform the clot solubility test by 5-mole urea, and you have to rule out the factor 13 deficiency. Or if it is also normal, clot solubility test is also normal, then you have to perform the chromogenic assay, because sometime in child may be having alpha 2 antiplasmin deficiency. In this case also, child will present with the bleeding manifestation, and you will not find any abnormal screening test. So in this case, you have to perform chromogenic assay. And sometime mild case of hemophilia or mild case of von Willebrand disease, they also present with the bleeding manifestation and all the screening tests are normal. So you have to rule out these also. Also, if you find the all screening tests are normal, then you have to think about vasculitis also. It can be congenital or acquired. In congenital, it can be due to hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, etc. Or in acquired, it's commonly HSP, Henoch-Schönlein purpura, or even in scurvy, Cushing syndrome. All screening tests will be normal, but the child is having bleeding manifestation due to vasculitis. So whenever there is no abnormal test in a screening test, then you have to also rule out the vasculitis. If the child is having normal PT, APTT and TT test, that means there is no coagulation disorder, and you have to perform the clot solubility test also to for the factor 13 deficiency. If this is also normal, that means child is not having any coagulation disorder. And if child is having other screening tests to be abnormal, Example, CBC, in which the platelet counts are decreased, and prolonged BT time, then you have to think about platelet disorders. So for the platelet disorder, we have to concentrate on bleeding time, platelet function analyzer, and the platelet concentration. So if the child is having thrombocytopenia, platelet count is less than 1.5 lakh per mm, and BT is prolonged, then you have to think about congenital thrombocytopenia. Either it is due to impaired platelet production as seen in the bone marrow disorder, and it may be due to increased destruction as seen in ITP, or it can be due to sequestration as seen in the hypersplenism. If the child is having normal platelet count with a prolonged BT, then you have to think about platelet function disorder, as it can be inherited or acquired. Inherited, Glenn-Schönlein thrombocytopenia, Bernard-Schuller syndrome, and von Willebrand disease. And in acquired, aspirin, clopidogrel, and uremia. If the child is having thrombocytopenia with the prolonged BT time, then you have to see the clinical appearance of the child. If clinically child is well, looking well, or in another condition, if child is looking sick. So if the child is looking well, then you have to see the morphology of the platelet. If the platelet is large in size, then you have to rule out either it is immune thrombocytopenia or non-immune thrombocytopenia. In immune, ITP, SLE, after some drugs, or in HIV infection. In non-immune thrombocytopenia, 2B or platelet type von Willebrand disease, hereditary macrothrombocytopenia should be ruled out. If the size of the platelet is small, then in congenital syndromes, TAR, thrombocytopenia associated with the absent radius, Viscote-Ehlers syndrome, X-linked amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, Fanconi anemia, and in acquired causes, after medication, toxin, and radiation. If the child is sick and size of the platelet is large and FDP increase, fibrin degradation product increase, then you have to rule out microangiopathy, HUS, TTP, DIC, thrombosis, neonatal sepsis. If the platelet is small with the hepatosplenomegaly, then you have to rule out malignancy, storage disorders. If you find any mass due to splenomegaly, then you have to think about hypersplenism, cause of the thrombocytopenia. And if the child is having hemangioma, that means again due to sequestration, child is having thrombocytopenia. So by this way, you have to approach a child with the thrombocytopenia with the prolonged bleeding time. If the platelet concentration is normal and BT is prolonged, then we have to perform the PFA 100, platelet function analyzer. Either patient is having the von Willebrand disease or platelet function disorder. If patient is having the prolonged BT or APTT is prolonged, and you are PFA is also altered, and you are suspecting von Willebrand disease, then you have to perform the von Willebrand factor antigen level, von Willebrand factor activity, restricted cofactor activity, von Willebrand factor multimers, factor 8 concentration, and LD repa, low dose restricted induced platelet aggregation. According to the result of these investigation, we have to make sure, is it type 1 or type 2 or type 3 von Willebrand disease. In type 1 and 3, von Willebrand factor antigen level will be reduced. In type 1 is a mild form, while the type 3 is the severe form. While in the type 2 von Willebrand disease, von Willebrand factor activity will be altered while the antigen level will be normal. And according to the various type, these reports will be altered, and factor 8 concentration will be very reduced in the type 3 in the severe form. So according to the type, all these results will be altered. If this is normal and you are suspecting the platelet function disorder, then either patient is having Bernard-Schlüter syndrome, in which platelet size will be large, big platelet, big B for big and B for Bernard-Schlüter syndrome. And in this, when you will test absent erythrocytin induced platelet aggregation will be there. While in Glenn-Schmann thrombocythemia, platelet size will be normal, and in platelet aggregation test, you will find the normal platelet aggregation to erythrocytin, but absent to all other agonist. So by this, we can easily differentiate. Now I will tell you the specific detail of the individual test. So normal platelet concentration is 1.5 to 4.5 lig per mm³. We label thrombocytopenia when the count is less than 1.5 lig per mm³. But generally, bleeding manifestations occur only when the platelet count is less than 50,000. And mild bleeding can be seen between 50,000 to 1 lakh. And it is the most common acquired cause of bleeding diathesis in children. Another test is bleeding time. It is very easy to perform, and normal bleeding time is 4 to 8 minutes. It is one of the bedside tests. It assesses the function of platelets and their interaction with vascular wall. Platelet counts of less than 1 lakh per mm³ are associated with prolonged bleeding time. When there is disproportionate prolongation of bleeding time, it may suggest a qualitative platelet defect or von Willebrand disease. That means whenever you are finding a patient with the normal platelet count and prolonged BT time, you have to suspect platelet function disorder, that means qualitative platelet defect and von Willebrand disease, as I said in previous slide. Now, platelet function analyzer, PFA-100, it measures the platelet adhesion aggregation in whole blood when exposed to either collagen, epinephrine or collagen ADP. It evaluates the early stage of hemostasis, platelet function and von Willebrand factor interaction. We know whenever there is a endothelial injury in the blood vessels, platelet adhere to the endothelium by the help of von Willebrand factor. So this is the adhesion stage, and after that platelet is activated and release the various mediator, and after that it express the factors GP2B and platelet aggregation starts. And PFA-100 is extremely sensitive to the presence of aspirin and may be used to monitor the antiplatelet drug therapy also. Now in platelet aggregation, we have to detect the qualitative platelet function defect. In this, platelet-rich plasma from the patient is activated with the one of series of agonists, ADP, epinephrine, collagen, thrombin receptor peptide and erythrocytin. As I said in my previous slide, that erythrocytin induced platelet aggregation will be affected in Bernard-Schlüter, while it will be normal in Glenn-Schmann thrombocythemia. Now the prothrombin time. PT measures the activation of clotting factors by tissue factor mediated thromboplastin extrinsic and Coleman pathway. Normal PT value is 10 to 13 seconds. And PT is not prolonged with the deficiency of factor 8th, 9th, 11th and 12th. So PT will remain normal in intrinsic pathway factor deficiency. Now APTT, activated partial thromboplastin time. It measures the activation of clotting factor by intrinsic and Coleman pathway. APTT uses the contact activator silica, kaolin and ellagic acid in presence of calcium and phospholipid. It does not measure the factor 7th, 13th or anticoagulant. Deficiency of contact factors. PTT can also be prolonged by the deficiency of factor 12, prekallikrein, and high molecular weight kininogen, known as contact factor, but they remain asymptomatic. So if the patient is having prolonged APTT but there is no symptoms, then you have to suspect the deficiency of contact factors. Now, thrombin time, it measures the final step in clotting cascade in which fibrinogen is converted to fibrin. Normal TT is 11 to 15 seconds. Prolonged TT is seen when there is reduced fibrinogen level, hypofibrinogenemia, afibrinogenemia, or dysfibrinogenemia, dysfunctional fibrinogen level, and in presence of substance that interfere with fibrin polymerization, such as heparin fibrin split products. So if the patient is having prolonged TT, then you have to differentiate, is it due to fibrinogen deficiency or dysfunction, or it is due to heparin. For this, you have to perform reptilase time. Reptilase time uses snake venom to clot the fibrinogen. Unlike TT, reptilase time is not sensitive to heparin and is prolonged only by reduced or dysfunctional fibrinogen and fibrin split product. It is not altered by heparin. So to differentiate between these two, is it due to heparin or due to fibrinogen deficiency, we have to perform the reptilase time. If TT is prolonged but reptilase time normal, that means it is due to heparin. It does not indicate the presence of reduced or dysfunctional fibrinogen and fibrin split product. Now, mixing studies, if there is unexplained prolongation of PT or APTT or TT, then mixing study is usually performed. Normal plasma added to patient plasma, and after that we have to repeat the PT and APTT. If correction of PT or APTT by 1:1 mixing with the normal plasma, that means there is deficiency of clotting factor. If PT or APTT is not corrected or only partially corrected, that means inhibitors is usually present, and you have to rule out the lupus anticoagulant or HIV viral infection in which the inhibitors are present. According to the previous reports, we have to perform the specific clotting factor assay. Severity of coagulation factor deficiency will be depend on factor level. If normal, between 50 to 150%, we label mild when more than 5% factor level, moderate when it is between 1 to 5%, and severe coagulation factor deficiency we label when it is less than 1%. Bethesda test. In this, we have to quantitate the amount of inhibitors of factor 8th or 9th. Whenever a patient is on treatment for the hemophilia A and B and receiving the regular factor concentrate, then we have to perform the Bethesda test. If the patient has developed the inhibitors to the factor 8th or 9th, then patient will not respond to the factor concentrate. So in this, we have to perform the Bethesda test to see the inhibitors level. One Bethesda unit is defined as amount that will inhibit the 50% of clotting factor in normal plasma. Thank you.